Hello, welcome to another virtual program with Maine Historical Society. I'm Kathleen Newman. It's August 9th, 2022, and this is Black Fashion History in Maine, examining the clothing in 19th century photographs with Dr. Karin J. Bohleke. Since 2007, Karin has served as the director of the Fashion Archives and Museum of Shippensburg University, and she also teaches in the Applied History Master's Degree program. She holds a PhD in French Language and Literature from Yale University and serves as an adjunct professor of French at Shippensburg. She resides near Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, where she likes to pursue her interests in historical fashion, needle arts, languages, social dance, and 19th century women's travel accounts. She's also a member of the Costume Society of America and has been a volunteer at the Adams County Historical Society and Gettysburg National Military Park Archives and Museum. Karin, thank you so much for joining us this evening.
Yeah, thank you for inviting me. I'm looking forward to sharing my current research with you. I'm not going to be presenting a spectrum of history and Black fashion through the 19th century. What I'm going to do is an examination of a series of 19th century photographs to show you what I see when I look at these photos, when I start and I study the clothing, and also to give you a sense of what to look for, because you'll see as I go through this presentation that the 19th century is very different in terms of how they viewed and understood clothing and how they used clothing. And I think for some people, you know, we may not realize to the extent to which we look at things through 21st century eyes. So let me start, and I'll get make sure this is working. All right. So one thing is I have this toolbar that hides some of what I want to see. Okay. So this is pretty obvious. Clothes tell stories, and it's very easy to misinterpret them when you are looking at them through modern eyes. And so here is a classic example. We have this little girl in obviously mismatched clothing. She's in, as you can see, she's from the Library of Congress. So one of the first things the 21st century person might think in looking at this little girl is, are they making do? Are her clothes so mismatched because she comes from a poor family? But then we look at these other photos, and now we have, on the right is more subtle, but we now have three little mismatched girls. So are they all obviously poor too? The one from New York is looking rather chic in her mismatched outfit. She's got a small print on her top and stripes on her bottom. And it shows a little more clearly on the other two girls that they have very, very different fabrics. And the little girl from Lancaster, I look at that and it's obvious to me that her mother's skirt has been cut down to make her a skirt. And because the pattern of the fabric is so disproportionate to her size. But then when you start getting into 19th century clothing practices, you realize that the first little girl I showed you, her mom is just a typical thrifty 19th century woman. And it makes perfect sense when you consider the fact that, of course, children grow very quickly. So you can see from this quote from the magazine, the Garibaldi bodies, that's another term for bodice, that's the little sort of blouse that the girls are wearing, are as popular as when first introduced for young girls. This fashion is both jaunty and economical, as old skirts with worn out bodies can thus be made useful. That is one thing to understand when you're looking at clothing from the 19th century, is that practices of thrift were so ingrained in the culture. But now let's look at this little girl a little more closely. She has very high quality accessories. That bonnet on the chair, that is drawn, it's something called a drawn bonnet. It's made out of silk taffeta. It's actually quite fancy. And this was not a cheap accessory. Women actually spend a lot of money on their bonnets. And of course, we can all think about the song, Easter bonnet and all of the thrills upon it. It was an important accessory for women. And she also had, trying to hide the panel that keeps blocking my view of my screen, I apologize. She also has very attractive side lacing boots, and they've got leather on the toes. If you look carefully, you see there's a straight line running across the front of her boots, and you can see the gleam of the fabric. It's probably a wool sateen. These boots are in excellent condition. They are probably fairly new, which means she comes from a family that can afford good accessories for her. She's not poor. She has a mother who's practical, who does what every other mother does in making over clothing for a child who's going to grow rapidly. Yet she is well accessoried in a way that shows she comes from a family that invests in good clothing and has money to do so. And as you can see, this should be a blast for the from the past for some of you. Clothing definitely dates us, which can be fortunate or unfortunate, depending on the time period in question. I don't know about you, but I think the mustard combination at the bottom is particularly bad. So let's talk about what happens when you have errors in the clothing dating. And this is particularly critical for this image also from the Library of Congress. So the catalog record reads, photograph shows an African-American woman, probably an enslaved nanny, with a girl and a boy from a Petersburg, Virginia family, circa 1860. And there's some problems with this, and I'll show you. The children's dresses tell a radically different story. The thing is, the edges of the skirts were cut in scallops. And the very first appearance of a scalloped hem in a garment shows up in December 1864. And you can see there are mentions in 1865 in the fashion magazines. So they recommend finishing the edge in scallops and binding them with a colored alpaca, which is basically a wool fiber. And then you can have rows of braid above the scallops, or they can be sewed in straight lines around the skirt, which is what this mother did in preparing the clothes of her little kids. And so we have, first of all, a trim that did not even appear in clothing until 1864. So already we have a problem with the 1860 image that is applied to this record. So now let's look at the nanny. She's wearing a sort of a striped printed cotton. As you can see, there are little motifs in there. The dress fits her absolutely perfectly across the shoulders. So this has been custom made for her. And it is, if anyone has sewed reproduction 1850s and 1860s clothing, it can be hard to get that dropped armhole. You can see the seam of the sleeve just falls over onto her upper arm. It can be difficult to get that to fall as perfectly as it does here without there being wrinkles and sort of an empty hollow in front of the shoulder. So somebody who made this dress for her did it absolutely wonderfully. Although I do wonder what's going on that her stripes aren't perfectly straight down the center front. In any event, we have a dress that is made by an absolutely excellent seamstress. And the big craze for the striped dresses actually comes in 1865 and 1866. And when you look at photographs of fashionable and reasonably fashionable women, both middle class and up, and even, you know, working girls, you see the popularity of the stripes adopted throughout the women. And now we add to this image that Petersburg, where this image is supposedly from, was under siege from June 9th, 1864 to March 25th, 1865. So given the date at which the scalloped hems appeared, I really doubt that mom got the kids all dressed up and took them to the photo studio while the city was under siege. That just doesn't seem to me like a sensible thing to do. Especially now, let's look at other images of these popular stripes. And here you can see a number of women, all these images, you can tell by the construction of the dresses and some of the details in their hair and in their collar shapes and so on. These images date from about 1864 to 1868. Again, we're at the mid-century mark and beyond. The peak years for those scallops is about 1866. So really what the record should read is the photograph shows an African-American woman, probably a formerly enslaved nanny, now emancipated and working professionally for wages with a girl and a boy from a Petersburg, Virginia family. And this is important. The redating is important because this woman, at the time this image was taken, is working for wages. She is a free professional. And to stick the slave label on her when that is indeed her past, in all likelihood, I am not belittling that, but now she is free and we need to put the free label on her. So these are the sorts of misinterpretations that can take place when looking at African-American images from the 19th century. And I'll give you another example. I was reading a study of African-American dress in the mid-19th century, and the author had illustrated her point with a picture of a woman, and the label was, she's wearing a necklace, and African traditions have a lot of bead necklaces, and here she is maintaining an African tradition. However, in the image, the woman wasn't wearing a necklace. She was wearing a watch chain, and it was a metal watch chain, not a beaded one. And the person writing about this woman completely overlooked the fact that she was wearing an extremely expensive silk plaid taffeta dress with enormous pagoda sleeves. So again, you have to understand 19th century dress to understand what is happening in these images. So let's talk about their attitudes towards clothing and what makes it very much a different time period. One of the first rules of being a good 19th century person was that you repaired your clothes. When you took them off at the end of the day, if you noticed anything wrong or anything and damage that had accrued during the day, you refixed it as quickly as you could. This is where a stitch in time saves nine comes into play, because doing one or two stitches early on saves you the work of doing nine or more stitches later on when the damage has become worse. The next thing you do is you restyle your clothing. And to us, that seems quite different, because after all, what do? Now we wear things a few times, the spontaneous holes develop in the wash and we throw it out. Back then, the quality of fabrics was generally higher, and it was a significant investment. Clothing was a very expensive part of people's lives. And so when the styles changed, you rearranged, you cut, you reshaped, you unpicked, you did whatever you needed to do. You took off old trim, you put on new trim, you restyled your clothing so that it fit the current styles, even if the fabric itself was not new. And then you reused the fabric. So the little girls having skirts made out of their mother's old skirts is a perfect example. The mother's dress could be something for the daughter. I've seen vests that were clearly made for men, but the fabric came off a woman's dress, for example. So it could even cross traditional gender lines depending on the nature of the fabric. And the other thing you have to understand that, especially in the 19th century and earlier, you are what you wear. So your clothing represents your moral character. Control over your dress meant control over yourself, morally, socially, and in every way that counted. And again, for us, that seems very strange, but when you think about it, studies have shown that we size up people we are meeting for the first time based upon their dress in 1.7 seconds, and we don't even realize that we've done it. And I always tell this to my students, that when they go into a job interview, you have 1.7 seconds to make a positive impression on that person so that you now can make your, you know, stake your claim to try to get the job. But if you dress badly, you've lost the job in 1.7 seconds. The other thing that happens in the 19th century is everyone wants to dress up in order to move up socially. And that affected how they shopped. When you were saving up for something, you wanted to save up to buy the highest quality you could afford. Now, the highest quality the town, shall we say, wallpaper specialist or bricklayer is not the highest quality that the lawyer on the square can afford, but you, clothing was an investment, so you made the best investment you could. You need to do that in order to move up socially. And nothing is more shameful in 19th century thought than to be in raggedy, torn, or damaged clothing. And again, this is very different, as I'm sure all of you have seen. For example, I don't know about campuses in Maine, but here in Pennsylvania, the students are all wearing jeans full of holes. That would have been a source of incredible embarrassment to someone in the 19th century, but it was also a sign that that person was morally degenerate. The other thing that happens is fashion is a culture of conformity. You do not express your individuality through dress. People who dressed too fashionably or too creatively were considered eccentric and strange. And again, there's something wrong with paying too much attention to fashion, because that also means that your mind is full of trivial issues. In addition, this is particularly important for women. Their dress should be age appropriate, and it should be economically correct. In other words, they should be dressing properly and well within their financial situation, and that they should not be overspending and driving the family into debt over something that amounts to vanity. There was also a keen cultural difference. Women wanted to be ladies. They were not women. Ladies were treated well. Women were not. So it has to do with the acquisition of not only the right wardrobe, but the right behavior, the right way of talking, and the right way of interacting and the people with whom you interact. Another aspect of the culture with the emerging culture of hygiene is that cleanliness also defined your moral worth. Your whites, namely your underpinnings, which at the time was a man's shirt, a woman's chemise and her petticoats and her drawers, they needed to be nice and white and clean, because we're think in terms of biblical quotes, you know, cleanliness of the inner vessel and things like that. And going to the photographer was also a major event. And this required careful wardrobe planning, because this was a formal portrait. When photos were invented right at the very end of 1839 in the form of the daguerreotype, people approached getting their portrait taken the same way they would have approached getting their portrait painted. This is why they are quite serious in their poses, that you rarely get a full natural smile. And a lot of the times people say, well, that's because the exposure took so long. Actually, depending on weather conditions, the exposure for your daguerreotype or your ambrotype might not actually be all that long. But think of it this way. Would the Mona Lisa look as good as she does if she had a big old cheesy grin showing her teeth? That was the thinking that went into going for your portrait. And typically, because it was an event, photos are limited to the major life changes that are also represented through changes or symbolic dress. Marriage, widowhood, graduation from high school, first baby, and similar events in human lives. And the important thing for African Americans, especially in the 19th century, is to show that they belong to society through correct dress. And fitting in and showing that they were worthy members of society through dress was an important way for them to join the culture at large. Sorry, there was a little problem with my screen share. So let's turn to some images from Maine. So here we have what is either the wedding or the engagement photo of Sarah Williams and John Young. They married on June 25th, 1864. They're both previously married. So here we have a very dark photo. As you can see, it is difficult to clarify what they're wearing, but what can we learn about them and their choice and style of clothing? So let's start with Sarah. You can see that she has fur draped around her neck, and she married in 64, and she was married at a time when fur styles are undergoing transition. And we are shifting from one major fur form to another. So let me show you some pictures. Sarah is wearing something called a tippet. That was also called, depending, because the vocabulary for fashion can be a bit unstable in the 19th century. It was also called a victorine. Unfortunately, the fur piece on the left has been called a victorine, and the fur collar on the right has also been called a victorine. So I'm going to be a little more consistent and specify collar versus tippet. Sarah has a tippet on, and think about the angle of why she had to put her gloved fingers on the fur. If she, wearing the long tippet, once she sat down, the tippet would hit her knees and it would form a ski slope down the front of her body. And among other things, it would make her look like she was wearing a tent. And so the photographer has very carefully posed her so that she could bring the tippet in flush against her body. And think about, and this is, it's very important what you wear for your portrait. She values her furs very highly, and she wants to be memorialized in them. Now, her husband, on the other hand, doesn't even have a winter coat on. So here you can see an announcement of fashion transition, that the collar is the latest and the most admired shape, but you can see they're still selling the victorines, and the front and back view here shows you how the fur has a nice quilted lining. So an added layer of warmth for the person wearing it. The fur is probably mink or muskrat. I actually sent an image of Sarah close up to the mammalian professor here at Shippensburg University. And he said the length of the fur puts it in the mink or the muskrat category, and both being populations that rebound quickly when they are hunted, especially, he said, in the case of muskrats. And I imagine, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, I imagine that muskrats at least are fairly common in Maine, and she could very well have purchased it locally. So now let's look at what else we can learn about Sarah. Well, we know she is a widow. I know her first husband had passed. They worked as domestics in a household of one of Maine's Supreme Court justices. And he actually had some very interesting opinions that he wrote that I shared with my husband. And we can talk about that later. But notice that her bonnet is very plain. We can see there's a frill of black net on the one side. We've got a black ribbon trim. She has tied the bow from ear to ear, which was the correct way to position a bow if you're tying your bonnet strings. And the bows are cascading down across over her fur. Sarah is conservatively dressed. She's stylish, but it's not exactly the cutting edge latest fashion. It's interesting, she covers her ears. That's an archaic style for 1864. And she noticed that she kept her gloves on as well, which is another choice. And again, this contrasts very interestingly from her husband. So my theory at the currently is that this is indeed their photo from their wedding day in June 1864, and she wanted the winter clothing to be part of her portrait, but her husband more or less thought to himself, I'm not doing that, which is why we see him without gloves and without a winter coat. Let's look at her husband. He has three pieces put on. His wool felt hat is informal, and it looks like he's taking it on and off his head quite a bit. There seems to be a bit of a dip from a hand grip that we can see on the left. He's got a good turndown collar. His cravat is small. The high button stance of his waistcoat is indeed standard for the early 1860s. And again, it's a little hard to see, and I have the high-res image at home, but if you look very carefully, you'll see that the lapel of his coat, his frock coat, almost touches the seam of his armhole. So let's look at some contemporary images. We have a wedding photo from 1864. Notice that the fashionable cut of the frock coat in the 1860s is already evolved into narrower lapels. Interestingly, his beard but no mustache style that was popular for men in the 1840s. By the 1860s, that's a conservative style for guys either who are older or just simply more conservative in their approach to their hairstyling. His coat is not new, and we know that John was not I would imagine he's not very highly paid. He's listed as a laborer in the census records. So he has made the investment, he's saved up, he's made an investment for a really good frock coat, which he is still wearing years later, because among other things, and this is part of 1860s dress culture, you take really good care of your clothes, especially because you want them to last. And this is his best coat, so he's not wearing it every day, and that's why it's still perfectly good for his wedding. And this is not unusual. We have in the fashion archives, we have an ID'd wedding coat for a wedding that took place in 1866. But the coat that the groom wore has a tailoring label in it, and the tailor went out of business in 1864. So when he went to his wedding in this coat, he was already wearing one he had, and it was already at least 2 years old at this point, if not older. So let's look at this unidentified young man from Lewiston. And he actually is from about 1880 to 1885. And again, looking at it through our perspective, we see a young man in a three-piece suit. And we think that's very formal. Obviously, when a young man puts on a three-piece suit today, he's probably going, among other things, to a wedding of some kind or a similar event. But then context is everything. This is actually an informal suit. This is something called a mourning coat. And in contrast to Sarah dressed in black as a widow, this spelling is M-O-R, not M-O-U-R. So let's look at this young man a little more closely. If you know, one of the first things that struck my eye is that he is wearing a coat back one way diagonal. And he's got the checked pants, and notice that the checked pants have the tuxedo stripe down the leg. That was a new fashion introduced to men's civilian clothing, basically because of the Civil War. It was a transfer of a military style to a civilian style. So we're mixing bold diagonal stripes with a check. And notice that he has jewelry. Jewelry was a slippery slope for men. They were advised not to wear too much. They didn't want to appear too flashy, because if they had too much jewelry on, they were conflated with gamblers and people of ill repute. And that's what you did not want. But the fact that he's got this bold diagonal and the check stripes, that actually makes him a young very fashionable man. When you look at pictures of slightly older men in suits of the exact same cut of the time period, or men who just simply appear a bit more responsible or are posed in a more professional capacity, they're wearing solids or a very just subtle texture in the weave. Something like a diagonal, that's for the young men. And I would point out that at this time period, ready to wear for men was actually pretty good, not perfect, but pretty good. So he would have been able to purchase this ready-made. And what's interesting is that I then was checking out 1880s photos of young men that we have in our collection. I found another young man who mixed stripes and a diagonal. Only you can see that his suit is not cut quite as sharply on the diagonal. And while he doesn't have rings on, you can see he's got a very bold cufflink and he's got the watch chain. And this is a good illustration to show you how unified the fashion culture was in the 19th century, that we can have a young man in Maine and a young man in Pennsylvania, functionally speaking, dressed in very nearly the same outfit. If you look, the cut on their collar is the same design, the little fold down tabs. One has a cravat, one has a necktie that resembles modern neckties. That's just personal preference. You can see, I think the man from Altoona is a little taller. That's just how his body's proportions strike me. But they're wearing basically the same thing at the same time. What makes this an early 1880s image? The curve of the coat, the presence of the breast pocket on the exterior of the coat. This disappears later on in the decade. And there's a slight taper, a slight narrowing to the trousers at the bottom. The other giveaway is the footwear. You can see the toes are slightly pointed at the sides, but are square across the top. That is a sign of 1880s footwear. So again, this is just a good reminder, and I'll keep repeating this, is that you have to understand 19th century clothing from the perspective of 19th century people to get a good grip on what is happening in the wardrobe. So here we have the McIntyre family photographed in Holton, and the father and the mother, Edna, were originally from New Brunswick. And the cataloging record indicates that they moved to Holton in about 1905. This image is definitely from about 1894, 1895. And what's the giveaway for this is the women's sleeves. You can date women's bodices of the 1890s just about to the year by the sleeves. And if you look at these ones, you can see how they fit close to the arm, below the elbow, and then flow out into a silhouette that would make a linebacker proud. And if you look in the here, you can also see some similarities. This is from a mail order catalog, and this shows how you could actually order ready-made skirts, ready-made bodices. This is from Philadelphia, and you can even see functionally from the perspective, the same shoulder tabs and from the mail order catalog to the daughter on the left. And if you look as well, the bodice with the shoulder tabs, you can see a pattern woven into the design in the mail order catalog. And then if you look at the mother, you can see the same idea. Different angle, different shape, but you're seeing again the same design aesthetic. And the mother, it's a little difficult to tell, but she has the very fashionable do of the little top knot right on the top of her head. And if you look at the mail order catalog, the top row, second woman from the left, you can see she too has a little top knot right on her head. But if you look at the third woman from the left in the catalog on the top row, you can see the parted hair in the center and the slightly waved effect of the hair on the side. And you can see that on both girls, both the daughters. And if you also look, you can see it on that same woman, top row, third from the left, ends poking out on either side behind her. That's a bow on the back of her neck. And you can see the mother and the daughter also have these back neck bows. And that's another characteristic of 19th century clothing, is that when a woman walked away from you, the details on the back of her dress were quite often very nearly as interesting as the details on the front. And then just to give you some contrast, we have a very sort of unhappy looking bride on the right from about 1900. And you can see how radically different the shape is for 1900. But you can see aesthetically, there are some similarities. We still have the high collar. We haven't moved away from that. We have the belting at the waist. We have textured, you know, it's textured wool. And what are two large lace straps in the McIntyre family on the daughter on the right, you can see that has also shrunk with the sleeves on this bride. You can see we now just have far narrower velvet tabs performing the same stylistic detail. Do a far better job of keeping up with hairstyles than this young lady from Baltimore has done. So I'm going to talk to you about one last image of a woman from Maine that I'm the one who figured out this image was taken in Maine. This is Christiana Freeman, and her mother was the forced concubine of Philip Livingston, who was a grandson of a signer of the Declaration of Independence. Her mother was from Jamaica, where the Livingston family owned a lot of land in addition to owning land in New York. And Philip Livingston forcibly removed her mother from Jamaica and brought her to New York. And Christiana was born in 1812. And that's a typo. It should say 1909, not 1809. I apologize for that. And Christiana was born, those of you who know your New York history, was born after the Gradual Emancipation Act was passed. However, she qualified as an indentured servant. So she owed her father her labor long after her mother was actually technically 100% free if she was still alive. And because this image has lost its case, the catalogers at the Library of Congress just simply said photographer unidentified. There are a number of features that make this an 1840s image. The hair comb showing on the top of her head, that's the hot look of 1847. The side lip ringlets is another popular look. The bodice fits in a V shape. You can see she's got what's called a chemisette underneath the open neck of her bodice. And the modern term for a chemisette is a dickey. She's got very tight sleeves cut on the bias so that the stripes of the fabric, which are horizontal, move on the diagonal over her arms. Her bodice is of a style that we call a fan front or a gathered bodice. And she lived, Christiana, lived in Portland, Maine, from 1841 to 1852. Her husband was Amos Freeman. He was a Presbyterian minister who had a congregation during those years. They later moved to Brooklyn. And the tablecloth, it belongs to Carleton. So those of you who know Carleton, the daguerreotypist, there are two daguerreotypes in the Maine Historical Society's collection with the exact same tablecloth. So because I was able to date the clothing, I was then able to identify the photographer, because based on her biography, I was able to situate her geographically in Maine. So again, it just goes to show you how important it is to look at clothing and interpret it through 19th century eyes. And I would add, in the case of Christiana here, she's wearing a really lovely dress. It is probably, the stripes are probably silk, and the the narrow ones and the darker ones are probably wool or a silk and wool blend. She was a seamstress, so it could very well be that her dress, she made her dress for herself. She did, it fits her absolutely perfectly. It's extremely high quality. So back to my statement, we need to understand 19th century dress through 19th century eyes and identify correctly what it is that we are seeing. And then, and this is particularly critical in the case of African Americans, we need to situate them correctly in time. As you saw with the nanny, making mistakes is confusing whether she is enslaved or free. So with that, I will stop sharing my screen and we'll entertain questions if you have any. And while I wait to hear the questions, I'm going to take a sip of water.
Sure. Thank you very much, Karin. Can you tell us just a little bit about how you got into doing this kind of work?
Actually, it's a good story. I published an exhibit catalog in connection with my job at the Fashion Archives. And in it, I made a dive into my personal photo collection and I illustrated clothing of the time period with photos of people from the time period from the collection. And there was a woman down in North Carolina, and my catalog was for sale in North Carolina. And she was the head of IT for the University of North Carolina. And so she traveled around from campus to campus and she popped into the museum, saw my catalog, saw that I'd used a daguerreotype to illustrate one dress. And she bought the catalog, brought it home to her husband and said, look at this. She writes about daguerreotypes. And her husband reached out to me. His name is Dennis Williams, one of the loveliest, most generous men I have ever met. And he asked me to write a report about the clothing in the daguerreotypes in his collection. And he offered to pay me. And he sent me some low res images so I knew what I was looking at. And I realized that he collected African-American images. And I said to him, do you know what Publisher Parrish is? And he chuckled because his wife, of course, works for the University of North Carolina. So he understood very well. And I said, could I write an article about this? And I did. I did an in-depth study of all the clothing in his images, and I published it in the Daguerrean Annual. So if any of you are interested in a far deeper dive into clothing and images, that article is available as a downloadable PDF from academia.edu, where I posted it under my name. After the article was out for a while, I posted it to academia.edu, where it went viral globally in under 48 hours. Literally, people all over the world read this article because I was the first person to sit there and focus entirely on African-American images and the clothing in the photos. And to understand the clothing, I had to understand, as I said, dating, clothing culture of the time period, but also dress construction and fit, seeing it on the body. Which is why I was commenting tonight about how some things fit perfectly, but the young stylish man wasn't quite so perfect. So I think his outfit's mail order. And then I decided that the need was there, and I'm actually currently working on a book. I am writing about African-American images from 1840 to 1920. And the reason I'm focusing on this time period is in Black dress research, most of the research focuses on clothing of the enslaved, even though at the time in the United States, there is a large free African-American population. And then they kind of don't do anything till the civil rights era. And I think part of the reason is when studying the clothing of the enslaved, because virtually nothing survives, people feel fairly comfortable working with the paper documentation that survives. Mm. When talking about the civil rights era, even though the guys of the 1960s are wearing skinny ties and tight cut pants, we can still relate to shirts, ties, suits, and dresses. It's harder to relate to bustles cages, giant 1890s sleeves. And so there's this real gap. And what has been very fortunate for me is people have been actually reaching out with their images and offering images that so I can write to them. So I'm hoping actually to, I've got about 100 pages written. Wow. And I've been working on this for a while, and it certainly is a timely topic. So I'm hoping to start finding a publisher by the end of this year.
That's great. And the book, is it a look at all of the United States of that time period, or the Northeast, or a specific region?
It's what I can get a hold of at this point. I've been working with Library of Congress in part because those are public domain images. Sure. And but I have photos from the Midwest, from the South, from the Northeast, from Pennsylvania, from parts unknown because we have no idea. And people, and what's interesting is when I do know who the person is, and I know far more, for example, about Christiana Freeman than I talked about tonight, because I was just going to talk about the clothes. I've woven their stories in with the textiles and how the textiles tell the story of their lives. But in the case of the unknown people, I look at their clothes and like, what can we tell about this person from the clothes? Because when all identity has been lost, when we don't know the photographer, we don't know the person's name, and when people are formal in their photos, the only thing that talks about them is their clothes. Mm. What do their clothes tell us? What can we glean about this person? What did this person value? How much money did this person have? And so that's what I've been working on. And so
that's great. Well, we're anxious to hear when you get a publisher and when we can see that. Someone in the audience is asking or mentioning the photo of the gentleman with the diagonal coat and the check trousers was interesting. Was that common across different social strata, or are we looking at a very fashion forward individual in that picture?
We're looking at a fashion forward young man. And let's think about it. Teenagers are always willing to, you know, push boundaries in fashion and other things more than, you know, boring married folks. So that is indeed a fashion forward look for a young man. So he's a very stylish dude.
Very much. Mm-hmm. Excuse me, folks, as I get over my cold. Another question: with African-American clothing, is there a lot of difference between garments from the southern states versus the north? Or, excuse me, are most of those differences tied to economic resources?
There are a couple things that I have noticed specifically in dealing with clothing from the south. And I would say that one of the biggest myths is that the south had different fashions compared to the north. One of the things that people don't realize is that there was no such thing as American fashion in the 19th century. Everything came from France. And we were so France dependent that during the Franco-Prussian War from 1870 to 1871, when Paris was under siege and fashion and information was not getting out, the world literally stopped any kind of fashion development and waited for Paris to be freed. We can't imagine that kind of dependence on Paris. I mean, it's still Paris, London, Rome, but Americans have developed their own fashion industry. So there was no such thing as American fashion in the 19th century. The biggest differences between North and South is that, and this is what the fashion magazines themselves acknowledge, is that people in the South are in cooler summer clothing sooner than their counterparts in the north, and that folks in the south don't need the same extent of winter gear that folks need in the north. Another major difference is they recognize, for example, that southern women spend more time in the saddle than northern women, because if they want to visit their girlfriend, they have to ride a horse because the estates were too far apart. So in other words, a man's shirt in the south is the exact same as a man's shirt in the north. The basic shape of a woman's bodice is going to be the same in the south and in the north. It's a question of fibers. That being said, I have noticed, now that I've been looking at a lot more images, when you look at clothing on folks in the South made, clearly made during the summertime. They cut, by the standards of the day, they cut the necks too big. In other words, they don't want a tight collar making them sweat. So the large fitting neck is something that I've noticed consistently across the board. So when you want to talk about differences in Southern fashions, you're it's subtle. It's instances like that. But again, in terms of economics, what you have is a common culture of dress. The way you construct the skirt of a poor woman is still the way you construct the skirt of a rich woman. The difference is in the quality of the textiles. And how well it fits, or maybe visible repairs. But the styles functionally are pretty much the same. And with the culture of cutting things apart and restyling them, you can update your look, even if you're dependent on your talented sister who's better with a needle than you are. The magazines are full of tips for changing worn out sections of gowns and spiffing them up at extremely little expense. So again, yes, there are economic disparities across the United States, but the culture of fashion in terms of the styles you are wearing and adapting your clothing to, that's pretty much the same.
Interesting. Well, thank you so much again for being here with us this evening and sharing your expertise. Just a reminder, folks, too, that this talk is part of our series for our Northern Threads exhibition. The exhibition is in a transitional period right now as we prepare part two. Part one closed July 30th, and part two, which is going to feature fashion pieces from MHS's collection from the 1890s to about 1980, will open this Friday, August 12th. So if you are excited to see part two, I hope we'll see you down there in person real soon. And if you didn't get a chance to see part one, visit mainhistory.org and you can still see the online version. And thank you, Karin, so much. Is there anything else that you wanted to say before we close out here this evening?
Just want to make sure, did everybody who had a question, did it get answered? Is everyone happy in that regard?
I think so. Was there anyone who had any burning questions that I might have missed? Put those in the chat right now. I think we got everybody.
Okay, I'm seeing some names of people I knew that, people I know that I didn't realize were even here. So, all right. Well, thank you for inviting me. I hope everybody learned something. I hope you enjoyed what I had to share. And yeah, and if any of you are wandering around museums and you see a really cool image of an African American between 1840 and 1920, you know, shoot me an email and let me know about it.
We will. Thank you.